at Cornell. She did her PhD here. And she's currently faculty at Ohio State University. She's an expert with strongly correlated systems, combining computational tools with analytical tools. So let's welcome Nandini.
Well, good morning, and many thanks to both Una and Eric for this invitation to speak here today. I am particularly delighted they have presented this challenge of doing everything on the blackboard, so that just generates more time for discussion, so please feel free to ask questions as we go along. I have to echo Una's perfect Ithaca, because I know, I used to be here, it really is always like this, so enjoy the weather as well as much as you can. I thought for my first lecture, I will tell you about some of my research on this topic of superconductor to insulator transition. That was the direction in which I worked on it. You know, so you start with a superconductor, and you might ask, how can we destroy superconductivity? And you know, you might think, you know, you could turn on temperature, or maybe disorder, apply a magnetic field, somehow change the Coulomb interactions, enhance the Coulomb interactions. All of these things would lead to a destruction of that superconducting state. And much has been done on this topic, up to some wave vector KF. And so you start with a metal, and then turn on some attraction, some coupling, G, and that leads to an instability. The smallest coupling, G, would lead in three dimensions, would lead to an instability, and you would get this, you would get a gap in the spectrum. So here is the gap, delta. Right, so this is an instability of the Fermi surface, and you get a gap which is much, much smaller than the scale EF. So in the metal, the scale was set by the Fermi energy, and when it gets unstable, delta is much, much less than EF, exponentially smaller than the energy scale EF. So that is our standard paradigm. It's an superconductivity is an instability of a metallic state. But the question we asked was, could an insulator which has no Fermi surface become superconducting? Okay, so it's asking the question the other way around, and it's actually very interesting what it leads to. So could an insulator with no Fermi surface become a superconductor? And so that's really the question I will focus on today. And I'm going to do this in the simplest example, with no disorder and so on. I'm going to make a few assumptions here. I will take this insulator to be one with no broken symmetry. So I'm really paring down the problem to its essential pieces. So I don't want complicating things like antiferromagnetism or anything, some other broken symmetry like charge density wave and so on. No broken symmetry. And even the superconductor I'm going to take to be just an S-wave superconductor. And let's say we restrict the discussion to dimensions 2. Okay? So that's what I want to discuss. And I'm going to base it off this paper of ours, Lo et al.
Would you, you wouldn't even have translational broken symmetry or crystal?
I will have translation. So I will show you right now. I'm going to take a band insulator, and so what I'm going to do next is to let me define the problem. So I'm going to basically take, so since Una said, you know, that you might just not let me go very far, maybe I should just even give you the result first. And just so you can stare at that, perhaps the best thing to do is to put it here and tell you what my main result will be. So I'm going to do this in the context of, let's say, a Fermi band insulator. Let's say this is some variable here. I use G for practically everything I don't know. So some tuning parameter G. And so he's going to start with the Fermi band insulator. And what I'm going to end up showing you is that there's no way to directly go from a Fermi band insulator to a BCS superconductor. So this standard paradigm is what is also called the BCS paradigm, Bardeen-Cooper-Schwefer. So there's no direct way. You have to go through two crossovers. So you necessarily go through a Bose insulator. And I will define what these are. And then this Bose insulator at the transition here will become a Bose-Einstein condensate. And that will then cross over to a BCS superconductor. Okay, so this is the actually the conclusion of this model that I will describe. But what I'm going to do it, I'm going to show you this through a precise model, but the conclusions are much more general than that. So the result is that there are necessarily two bosonic phases that intervene before a band insulator can become a standard BCS superconductor. So let me just say in a nutshell what these states are. So since I have a band insulator, I have sort of like these two valence band and conduction band. And let me set the chemical potential here in the middle. So the one energy scale is this one. It's the single particle gap scale here. Let me call that E1 particle. Okay. So that is a band insulator. Now, what's a bosonic insulator? A bosonic insulator, because I have attraction, so these states are all filled, because I have some attraction, I can make two holes here and put two particles here. And this, these two particles and two holes can form bound states right there within the gap. So this energy here is the two-particle state. So in a Fermi band insulator, E1p is greater than E2p. And in a bosonic insulator, they switch their energy scale. So the two-particle scale becomes less than the one-particle scale. Okay, so it becomes cheaper to create two particles or remove two particles compared to adding one particle or removing one particle. That is what I will call a bosonic insulator. And in the BEC, so I'm describing all of these phases through their excitation spectrum.
So the Fermi insulator, I think you...
I'm sorry?
The Fermi insulator from the suite.
The
sorry. I'm so sorry. Yeah, That was a test to see that you are a reed. So E1P is less than E2P, and here's that. Yeah, good. So, now the BEC, now you may have heard lots of different things about BEC and BCS in terms of the superfluid stiffness and the gap scales. Here in terms of the excitation spectrum, I will show you that there is a sharp point where the topology of the excitation spectrum changes. And I'll describe this in more detail. But essentially in the BEC, we will see that if you look at the minimum gap locus. Okay, so this space here is kx and ky, then the minimum gap locus is a single point at k equal to 0. And in the BCS case, the minimum gap locus will turn out to be a contour. So this is what I will now discuss in more detail, but let me just at least put that up first before I go into the details. But that's the crux of what I will do. And just to put it in context of a lot of activity today in our field, this will also form the backdrop of topological insulators and topological superconductors, which I won't discuss here, but that's something we are actively researching. You can ask similar questions. Does a topological insulator always become a topological superconductor? Or under what conditions does it? So this kind of investigation plays into that question as well. And now if you're looking for other contexts where such problems will become interesting, there are many low density systems. You know, now you can take these transition metal dichalcogenides and dope it very lightly. So you are kind of in the regime where you don't have a huge Fermi surface that you are making unstable on a scale much smaller than the Fermi surface. Your Fermi energy is becoming very small if you have low doping. So that's another place where such investigations become useful. Okay.
So am I supposed to think of G as some interactions? Like on the far left, it's zero interaction, the far right, it's super strong interaction?
Yeah, no, I'm going to show you. So what G is will become now clear. I have to write down the model and then show. But it will be, you will see now a combination of attraction and another parameter. So let me come to the model now. Any other questions on this before we delve in? Okay. Okay, now comes the precise model so we can understand exactly what G is. So the model I'm going to write down is, so you can think of taking, let's say, a rung of this kind. I need two atoms in the unit cell, right? That's the first thing. If I want to make an insulator, I need either two orbitals on each site, and then I want to connect different sites, or I can take an object like a rung and then make a lattice out of this. So let's say I take a triangular lattice. Okay, I make a triangular lattice. And why do I take triangle? Because I don't want any other broken symmetries, like CDW instability and so on. But as I said, none of these things are really critical. Ultimately, that's a very general result that we are getting at the level of physicists. You know, we might even call this like a proof. But I'm kind of careful to say that. Let me just say it's a very general scenario. Okay, so I'm taking a triangular lattice and coupling it. So there's one triangular lattice here, which has a hopping T between sites. And it has some, so let me actually write the whole thing. So I have H, which is minus T. Within that layer, and it has a second layer that it couples to. Here, a second layer, T curve. Okay, so this is a bilayer problem, and to that I now add attraction. It's like an attractive U-Hubbard model, but it's a bilayer. And then there is a chemical potential. And I'm going to set mu, so choose mu, so that the average density is equal to 1. You can generalize this model to the dope case as well, but this is kind of the simplest you can put out. So this is the bilayer.
What did you call the rung model?
So each of these, sorry, I didn't put it properly. I didn't make my figure the best. But you can think of each of this. So I have, let's say, the two layers are on top of each other. And this one is sitting right on top of, let's say, this one. And that's my rung. So you can think of taking rungs and just making a triangular lattice out of it. Okay. Now, what we would like to do is to get the phase diagram of this. So let me do that on, just put down here. So what one would like is to get this phase diagram. And I'm going to slowly fill it up as we go on. So one axis here is T over T curve. So T curve, which is the hopping between the layers, I'm going to use as my scale. And this is U over T curve. And I'd like to get the phase diagram. So G will end up being a parameter, which could be these tuning parameters in terms of which I will try to get the phase diagram. Okay, so is the problem clear? Okay. Now, the nice thing about this problem is you can apply different techniques. So that's another reason why I picked this for the school. Firstly, it has some generality about the results. And you'll see many different techniques that one can use to understand the different limits. And it's also an interesting case where we found that mean field theory breaks down hugely. Usually, you know, I've worked on so many different problems, and mean field theory gives you a pretty good first step understanding, which is then refined by quantum fluctuations. But in this problem, we found that mean field theory actually breaks down in a large part of the phase diagram. So that's what's kind of useful. So what we will see is, the simplest limit might be to start here at zero attraction and just increase the hopping. So that, of course, is...
Sorry, is this finite temperature?
Good. I'm going to... This can be done at finite temperatures also, but let me say for today, I will just make you the phase diagram and pick just zero temperature. But finite temperatures, once you get the energy scales, then those will translate into temperature, and you can see how that will open up the temperature, another axis on this, which would be temperature. Okay, so what you will see is that we can apply different things. At very small u, essentially you can use diagrams. and mean field theory here. On this axis, pretty much you can assume T is zero, so this is more like your atomic limit or like a Rung limit. So that works very well here. At extremely large U over here, essentially this attraction leads to a bosonic object, a Cooper pair, tightly bound Cooper pair, and that's a kind of a bosonic calculation. So you have like all these places you can do different things, and in the middle, where all the energy scales are kind of comparable, that's where you have to then turn to something non-perturbative, and quantum Monte Carlo is the method of choice in the middle. So in that way, applying all of these different methods, we can then get the phase diagram, which I will put up for you.
So there is spin degeneracy and also the layer, degree of freedom?
Yeah.
And your attraction is within the layer?
On-site, on both layers. Okay, so let me, so this won't move, so unfortunately I wrote the Hamiltonian on that, but never mind. We have that to guide us. Okay, so let's look at different limits. So the first limit is U is zero and N is one. So this is non-interacting. Okay, so what we get is are basically these rungs, which, and each rung is essentially giving you two levels. So let me actually, each rung, if I look at a fermion on this rung, I get two levels, a bonding and an antibonding level. And now when you put many of them together, so let's say I now put many of these. And this energy scale here is T curve. Now when you put many of these, then each of these is going to broaden. This is energy here. Each of these will broaden by an amount T. This is T curve. Right? So essentially you can see that as T curve, as T over T curve increases, then you will get an overlap of these density of states. And you'll go from a Fermi band insulator, how's that, FBI, to a metal. So that's our first critical point here. We get, at some point here, we go from a Fermi band insulator to a superconductor. Okay. And no, not superconductor yet, just a metal on this line. It's a metal. And the smallest U that you turn on then drives this into a superconductor. In the band insulator side, since there is a gap, it protects it and it remains a Fermi band insulator, even away from the zero U line. So that's good. We get some idea here. Now let's go on the vertical axis. So let's set T equal to zero and increase U. And this is where so that's, this was easy. The second one is also easy. It's the atomic limit. Where T is zero. And now we, on a given rung, what I have is the total number of fermions I can be zero, one, two, three, or four. Right? That's the total number I can have. And the ground state, you can show very easily that the ground state has and this state is basically a linear combination of of we call this A and B. So it's a linear combination of it changes from that to this is higher, this is lower. That's what drives this gap. This is the E1P. And this is the E2P. Because I'm changing two particles. Good? Everybody with me?
Can you explain how do you get this order of the energies of different levels?
Yeah. So you can just look at this problem here with n equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and take that Hamiltonian, diagonalize it. And you will see that the structure of your states, this is your ground state, the amount of, and then relative to that, you can get your excited states. And this is the, naturally, as you would expect, this is how your spectrum will come out. So you're essentially taking that capital N as your quantum number and organizing your states within that.
Sorry.
Yes.
Does the ordering depend on chemical potential?
At this point, my chemical, all it cares about is the chemical potential must be within the gap. So I'm at filling of one.
I'm asking because N equals 3 and 4 couple differently with mu, so.
No, it does not depend. It does not depend so long as the chemical potential is in the gap, right? So what I'm doing is I have to self-consistently determine my chemical potential to get a certain filling. Okay, so the chemical potential will move with U, and it will produce Hartree shifts. Yeah. Okay. So that's the story here. So I can put some numbers here just for the triangular lattice. This turns out to be 2.9. The specific numbers are not so important, but I just want to put them down here. This is 2. And now, similarly, I won't dwell on this too much, but you can do also a strong coupling expansion and show that on this axis, you can do a bosonic problem at strong coupling and show that you can get a transition here from this is going to be like a Mott insulator of bosons.
Nandini, why don't you write that in the black pen? That the red's a little hard to see
okay.
Here farther back.
I left my black pen somewhere. That's a Mott insulator. Oh, sorry. Yeah. it's a Mott insulator of these Rung bosons. And this is a superfluid. And that transition happens at this point of around 0.4 T over T per. So what you see is this line kind of bends in that direction. Okay. So what we have managed to do now is get some of these endpoints and to see how this two-particle scale evolves as you, in, so taking a cut like this, one would like to see how does this this Fermi band insulator scale to a bosonic insulator, how does that evolve? That we can look at now here. So this is a, this line here is a Bose insulator. And here also we have a Fermi band insulator. So that's how much we have identified. Okay, now.
Sir, yeah, I had a question. In the limit of like infinity U, intuitively I think like the N equal to 4, the state should be the ground state, right? If I understood. Because why is it for the
So I'm still, even in the atomic limit, all along that, this is coming because I'm keeping my chemical potential at the middle. But yeah, I'm always keeping my chemical potential such that my kind of my average density is at 1. So, okay, now let me try to take a cut. I would like to get some more boundaries here, so let me take a cut now.
The average density of 1 is n equals to 2 for the two sides. That
yes.
One.
Yes. As opposed to a maximum of 4.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we get into the third part we can look at is the pairing instability. Coming from the band insulator. In a band insulator. And for this, we want to look at a pair property. So like pi ij as a function of t. Ci up t, ci down. So essentially what I'm doing is I'm creating a pair at t equal to 0, destroying it at the time t at two different sites, I and j. And from here, you can calculate the pair susceptibility. You can get the, of course, the full propagator, but you can even just get the static susceptibility chi. And so if I'm taking a cut like this at some fixed u, then this quantity chi as a function of t over t per at some fixed u. This susceptibility is essentially going to be finite in the insulator, and it will diverge as you hit the insulator to superconductor boundary. So just as you hit the superconductor, chi will diverge. Another way to think about it is to look at the you know, within like a RPA, you can have these two pairs propagating, interacting with you, and chi of omega will be basically, let me write, chi omega inverse is chi zero of omega, and chi zero is the usual. That's the non-interacting pair susceptibility. So the main point of this is that if I look at chi of omega as a function of omega, its poles, just like the single particle Green's functions tells you about the poles tell you about the single particle excitations, here the poles will tell you about the pair excitations. And so you'll get a pole here, let's say at some energy which is like E2P, and on very general grounds this is anti-symmetric, so that's also should have the same height. That's minus E2. Okay, so sorry, this should have been symmetrically placed. So what you see again is that so this is all happening at some fixed U. So as I take a cut from here, let's say I'm taking a cut like this, at some fixed U, then this two particle scale, E2P, is going to do the following. So this is T over T perp, and what you will see is that, let's say here's my single particle scale, I'm just drawing it as a constant, it's not a constant, it has some variation, but the two particle scale is going to go soft at the transition. So at some point, when you go from an insulator, so you're seeing now the crossover scales. So this was your Fermi band insulator. This is my E1P, E2P, Fermi band insulator. This region over here is the Bose insulator. And on this side now, the system becomes a superconductor. And exactly what kind of a superconductor we will analyze. So this is the way you can start to get a boundary here. And the boundary that you will find is the following. So we get one boundary here from, this is a crossover scale. So let me draw that dotted. Okay. So that's the crossover scale from a Fermi band insulator to a Bose insulator. And then this other scale here, so this boundary here is obtained by the gap scale switching between the one particle and two particle gaps, and this boundary here is obtained by 1 over chi going to 0. Or you can say by the E2P going to 0. Both of those will give this boundary. Let me take a minute and just wait and see if everybody is on board with that.
Are these second-order transitions?
Yes. So this is a second-order transition, essentially in the universality class of the D plus one, so like 3D XY universality. because it's a 2D spatial and 1D coming from the quantum part. So it's essentially in the 3D XY universality class. Yeah.
So how long will the metal phase and the superconducting phase will overlap?
The smallest U will drive it superconducting. So the metal really exists only on that line. Yeah, metal is only on this line right here. This is the metal. Okay, so let me write a little bigger here that this entire region is a Bose insulator. Okay.
So Nandini, if I had a material which I thought might be this, in this Bose insulator region, what would I do to detect that?
That's a good question. So people have not really seen these because mostly the probes of the superconductor insulator transition has been transport. And transport is messy. So in transport, you would have to look at the gap. The transport on the insulator side would be activated, and it would have a gap, but then you have some details to look at those gaps. So a better way to find this is our proposal, is that you should be looking for actually excitations that I might call Cooperonic. So you know, you have let's say in the insulator. So in the insulator, I was drawing these sort of these are like excitons, except these are bi-excitons. These are like I call them Cooperons. Because I want to distinguish them from excitations like which are particle hole channel. This would be in the particle hole channel, and this would be a particle hole channel bi-excitron. And this is in the particle-particle channel and a Cooperon. So you would have to use optical methods. It's primed for optical methods to explore this insulator. It hasn't been done. But you know, people like G. Shan and Mark and Tony Hines, those are the kinds of experiments that need to be done on these materials.
Could you do this tunneling from a superconductor into it?
Okay, let's come to tunneling in a bit. You can. So let me say that right away. So if you try to do single particle tunneling, you will pick up the E1 key. But if you try to tunnel a Cooper pair, you will see E2 key. Again, it has not been done because tunneling into an insulator is difficult because of charging effects. But if you are close to the transition, the gap, the two particle gap is actually becoming soft. It's going to zero at the transition. So then you can tunnel on the insulating side. Again, these experiments have not been done. So you can see there are many, many open questions here. People have looked at this with disorder, but that has its own angle, which we can discuss later. Okay, so we have that picture. Now the question is, I want to say a couple more things. One is about mean field theory, and I can actually draw a little sketch of the mean field theory. The main message about mean field theory is that it does not work. So I won't dwell too much into that, except maybe to just give you the phase diagram with the mean field. So I don't want to actually corrupt that because that picture is correct. Whereas the mean field phase diagram turns out to be this. So this is the mean field theory. U over T perp, T over T perp. Here was the Fermi band insulator to metal. This turns like this. And there's a small sliver of a Bose insulator, and practically, I don't remember exactly how this goes, but this is the crossover. So let's say this is BCS, BEC, Bose insulator, band insulator. So that's the mean field picture, right? So what you main thing that you notice is that the Bose insulator in mean field theory is very tiny, whereas in the actual analysis that we did, the Bose insulator is a very large part of the phase diagram. So that's one thing. And the main reason for that is that mean field theory does not include the fluctuations. So it's finding a large Bose-Einstein condensate phase, which actually is destroyed by quantum fluctuations. And this is where I now turn to some Monte Carlo results, which allow us to establish this boundary in another way, coming from this side. So coming from the superconducting side, we can do quantum Monte Carlo and calculate the superfluid stiffness, and that going to zero marks this boundary. So this boundary is marked by superfluid density going to zero. So that's how we can get that boundary. Now, I could show you, I'm going to run out of time, but the main second part I wanted to show you was on the excitations on the superconducting side, so let me turn to that. So, as I said, we have understood this part. The superconductor has also a crossover within it, and that crossover has some boundary like this. It goes from a BCS to a BEC. And the way we can see that boundary is, again, through its excitation spectrum. Let me come to that. So usually, when you have crossovers, you don't have sharp signatures. That's the nature of a crossover. But in the excitation spectrum, we are noticing something quite sharp between the BCS and BEC regimes. Okay. So BCS part, let me start with that because I think you're more familiar with that. So the Hamiltonian, once you have that metallic instability of the metal, the Hamiltonian is of this form. You have this particle hole mixing that generates the quasi-particles of the superconductor with some pairing delta. So what you essentially can get here is, let's say, an epsilon, and the Ek is so you have your mole, your energy eigenvalues epsilon k versus k. This is the bare spectrum, and that gets mixed with the hole part, which is here, right? And that mixing then just generates a gap right here. So this is delta. Now the difference, so if you look at your minimum, so this is happening at Kf. So the minimum gap, if I were to now look at follow this gap in K space, then you will basically map out a contour. For the triangular lattice, it is some kind of a hexagon, but you know, essentially it's going to be some closed contour. So this is Kx, Ky. And so this thing here is the minimum gap locus. I look in K space and see where is the gap minimum. Another way to think about this is to look at the spectral function, A of k of omega, and this is vk squared delta omega minus ek, actually plus ek, so on the negative side, plus uk squared delta omega minus ek. Right? So essentially, if you are doing looking at the spectral function, then you see that here is the chemical potential, that's omega. These are different cuts, a different A of k, and you essentially see a backbending. This is kf. These are cuts at different k, so you have these vk squared. At kf, you get a weight of exactly half, and then it bends out. And on the, this is my vk squared, and here I have the uk squares, which are very small here, becomes exactly half at the back bending point, and then uk is the one which is dominating. This is very small. I don't know if you can see this. This is large, less, this is exactly half, and this is very small. Now, the difference on the BEC side is that in a BEC, essentially what is happening is you have your, the perturbation of the Fermi surface is greater and greater because you are making very tightly bound Cooper pairs. So if I'm trying to look at n of k, which is my distribution function, this is all at zero temperature. In a BCS regime, it's perturbed only near Kf. Let's put this as energy here. But as you go toward the BEC side, more and more of this is getting perturbed, and your chemical potential is moving to the negative side. It's moving in this way. So the result of that is, if I were to draw the same kind of energy versus, let's say, you would see some backbending happening like on this side. So this is your spectrum. And this is zero energy here, that's epsilon k. And you see that because my chemical potential has moved to the negative side here, essentially, if I were to look at the density of states in a tunneling experiment, you would see something quite different in the two regimes. So in the BEC side, you would basically see just a drop like this, very sharp drop, and a very tiny feature on the other side. So highly asymmetric. Highly asymmetric with a sharp jump on one side. On the BCS side, it is the usual case where you get a square root singularity. On this side. So the square root singularity comes from essentially the flattening of the spectrum right around Kf. So that's the main difference in the excitation spectrum in the superconductor. So now you have the full picture about the spectrum here. Here you get this contour. Here you get basically a Fermi point, which is Bose condensation at k equal to 0. The minimum gap, as you can see here, is happening at the gamma point. Okay? So I want to turn in the next few minutes, just show you one piece of data where this has just been observed. But before that, let me just make sure that this phase diagram is now all clear to all of you. Yeah?
A question about the Bose insulator to the Mott insulator of bosons.
No, it's not. I'm just, no, that's just the same thing.
Okay.
It's, I should not even have used a different word. But it's just that in the very large U limit, it essentially becomes a MOT insulator to superfluid transition. The difference is that this MOT insulator is what I would call a fat boson. So usually in a MOT insulator, you are at integer filling. And if you have two sites, that would have been two bosons, right? So these bosons are hardcore bosons because they ultimately are made up of fermions. And a single boson lives on both sides of the rung. Okay, so is this clear about the main difference between a BCS and a BEC superconductor is that the chemical potential is negative, and as a result, in the BCS superconductor, the gap is given by delta. In the BEC superconductor, the gap is given by E gap of the insulator squared plus delta squared. Or another way to, you can see that from here itself, since the gap is opening at the gamma point, epsilon k is zero, so the minimum gap becomes mu squared plus delta squared. Or mu is the same thing as having your single particle gap. So your superconductor is emerging in a state which still has a single particle gap, E gap, zero, and that square plus delta square gives you the full gap in the BEC. Okay.
But that's not visible from the density of state. If I just look at the density of state and look at the gap, I will only see delta. Because your plot of the density of state.
Yeah. Actually, no. Sorry. I should actually call this
E gap.
E gap. Yeah, thank you for that. E gap and E gap. Okay. So let me just turn very quickly to the So this is just to show you some of the Monte Carlo results, which are harder to display on the board. But I will show you one experimental result. These are the two things. So this is using quantum Monte Carlo and maximum entropy to extract the single particle spectral function. So here's the Green's function in imaginary time from which we can do analytic continuation and get the spectral function. And you can see that all through this this transition here, so this is sitting at a particular cut. This is sitting at some cut like this, where let's say we are increasing T over T per, so a horizontal cut. And you can see that you're starting out in the insulator. Here it has some Fermi band insulator. It always has some kind of gap through the entire transition. The nature of the gaps are changing. Like here it may start out as the Fermi band insulator, then at this superconductor transition, the gap is now, your system is entering the BEC, so it still has a gap. It's the single particle gap which has not closed. The two particle gap is closed, but the single particle has not closed. So that square plus the delta square gives you the gap in this region, and then it kind of crosses over more into the BCS region. So, and then you can look at this minimum gap locus. You can look at the, from this, instead of doing analytic continuation, which is a little imprecise, you can directly even look at G of K and tau. It has this exponential decrease as a function of tau. From that, you can read off Ek, and at each k point you can read off this epsilon k, and from that you can then make this you can get the renormalized spectrum of the Bogliubov quasiparticles in the BCS direction. You can see there is this nice backbending, and from that you can look at where the minimum gap locus is as a function of k, and you get this hexagon. So it's a contour, and the contour is obtained at epsilon k equal to mu. But on the BEC side, what you see is that this chemical potential has become negative, so you're seeing just this part of the spectrum, the rest of it is on the negative side, but the minimum gap locus now has become the gamma point. Okay, I'm skipping that. Here is some data from Amit Kanigal's group. And this is selenium, this is Fe1 plus Y, selenium X, tellurium 1 minus X. And the key thing they noticed, you know, it's very easy as theorists, we just put some parameter G. And G can be attraction. And the experimentalists will ask you, how do we tune attraction? And the thing to remember is it's always a dimensionless quantity. So it's delta divided by EF that you are trying to tune. So while delta is harder, you know, attraction is hard to tune, you can tune EF. And that's what they realized here is by controlling Y, you can tune the Fermi energy. So again, I don't want to dwell too much, just to show you this plot here, that they go from, by changing Y, they can change this ratio delta of over EF from 0.16 to 0.5, which is enough to take them from, so these are the actual experiments. This is the theory that is reconstructed, you know, to kind of match these experiments. And you can see the backbending here. Here is this band here that I was showing you, which is backbended here. The intensities are just these Vk square and Uk square. So, and this is then on the BEC side, all the action is happening at the gamma point. Okay, so with that, let me stop and take questions. I hope what I've conveyed to you is, in a very controlled example, shown you the criteria for these different kinds of insulators as well as superconductors. So next time anybody says, you know, we get an insulator, we should ask the next level of question, which is, what kind of insulator? Bosonic or fermionic, and we have to have more information based on the character of the excitations on the insulating side. Similarly, when people say it's a superconductor, we should ask, is it a BCS or a BEC type? And there again, it's useful to have more information besides the gap, what is the stiffness, and even more, the excitation spectrum. And this, I think, in a way, prepares us very well for understanding more current topics of topological insulators and superconductors. Okay, thank you very much.
Questions? Yes.
The quantum Monte Carlo you use is determinant of quantum Monte Carlo?
Yes. Okay. So it turns out this is attractive U. So essentially in Monte Carlo, and maybe you'll hear about it from some of the other speakers, but what you're trying to do is take the interaction term and write it as a non-interacting fermion moving in some auxiliary field. That's all very well and good, except that usually fermion problems have this sign problem in the determinant, but here it turns out for the attractive case, you get a determinant of up and down fermions, but if one of them changes sign, the other also changes sign. So you have a net a probability that you sample, which is always positive. And this is true for any chemical potential. If you don't have to be at half filling, any chemical potential, and you still don't get a sign problem. So that's another very nice reason to do this, because then you get unbiased results in the intermediate coupling regime.
Any other questions? Yes?
Is this generalizable to nodal spectrum activity?
Nodal superconductivity, so like D wave superconductivity. That's interesting. It's generalizable in the sense if the phenomenology is quite different. Because you know, when you have D wave superconductors, then you have lobes which are positive and negative when your gap changes sign. So superconductivity can get destroyed more easily there. But again, there are quite a lot of puzzles even there. So you know, historically, this is how I actually entered the field, trying to understand D wave superconductors and disorder, because cube rates are extremely robust to disorder. And the question is why it's a D wave superconductor. So in trying to answer that, we have constantly taken steps back. First, we started understanding S wave with disorder. And you know, the latest thing was even no disorder. So I would say D wave will be, phenomenology will be different, but a similar analysis can be quite rich.
How much does that picture change with when you change the doping? For example, if you put doping to 0 or 1, that would just all become modified, right?
Yeah, so if you look up that reference, I said we have looked at the doped case as well. And just like in the Bose-Hubbard model, you get those lobes, where you have MOT lobes and then superconducting regions. Here you will also get lobes where you will have sort of a Fermi insulator, Bose insulator, and BCS, BEC, those regions, and they will form different lobe-like regions. But we have a phase diagram for that as well. Some of those can be more relevant for transition metal dicalcogenides because they often can gate them and change the doping. So, very low density systems are in the class of problems I talked about. Because then, for example, bismuth is an interesting example. It has one electron for every 10 to the 5 atoms. It's a very low density system. So when you have that lower density, the Fermi energy has become really small. So whatever attraction you have is essentially perturbing all the states. And that momentum distribution that I showed you is essentially getting perturbed for all momentum. So you're very quickly going into a BEC regime.
There was a question here.
Yeah.
It's a very non-reverse question, but the two particle energy gap being 0, is that equivalent to having superconductivity? Is a bosonic metal a superconductor necessarily?
Okay. The two particle gap going to 0 basically says now you can inject pairs with 0 energy. So that's certainly something you need to get a superconductor, right? You have to be able to inject pairs. A superconductor is more than that. You also must have finite stiffness. I did not dwell on the stiffness too much, but the stiffness is essentially you have a phase. The superconducting order parameter has an amplitude and a phase, and there must be a cost to twisting the phase. So in a bosonic metal, you would have no gap to add in a Cooper pair, but you would have 0 stiffness. Okay. Now in this model, we don't get such a bosonic metal. So that line that I showed you here, this is where the two particle gap goes to 0, and on this side, the stiffness becomes finite. So here, there is no bosonic metal. If there had been so I should say that in a real system, there are indications that, so in experiments, people are reporting a bosonic metal. By that I mean a state that does not have 0 resistance, but a very small finite resistance. And this is being called a bosonic metal. And if that were there, it would be in this kind of region here before. So you go from a bosonic insulator, some metal state, and then a superconductor.
How do you use bosonic in an experiment?
So that's part of, you don't know they are bosonic. You actually don't know in the experiments because you have to measure the gap. So in a way, my talk is also revealing all the quantities you really need to have control over to make hard statements. You need to know these gaps, the nature of the gaps, stiffness, all of that. Then you can put together a proper picture. In the absence of that, the field has a lot of speculations. So that is why I didn't want to go into that part of it, and I tried to focus on some calculable things. But this is in terms of open areas of research, this is one of those. The metallic state, is it bosonic? Is it fermionic? Not clear. Coulomb interactions could be really important. And you know, at some level, you don't want to put everything into your theory because it becomes unmanageable. But these are really the ingredients that have to be put in for a complete theory. Also, the phenomenology with a magnetic field, how you drive it, superconducting. And it's very easy to say it's a parameter G. But G, whether it's disorder or whether it's magnetic field, also has different phenomenology. Yeah.
A few months ago, on a bilayer graphene with twisty angle, it showed that there's more insulated metal and superconducting like phase diagram. So
yes.
Does this have any relation to your model
here? Yeah. I think that is a very good case to look more in detail. Because so the main thing I'm saying is that when you have a superconductor very close to an insulator, the seeds of the pair are already there in the insulator. So the object that will become paired in the superconductor already pre-exists in the insulator. So now in those Pavlov's experiments, you have an insulator which has, let's say, spin liquid, or you know, that way it's not breaking more symmetries. So you have some RVB singlets, which are your preformed Cooper pairs already in the insulator. This should be looked for. And then, because of some kinetic constraints, those Cooper pairs and those singlets are not able to move, very much like the high TC phenomenology. And then as you dope it away from half filling, they are able to move. Similar here, there's that magic filling, and then you can start getting superconducting. So I think this kind of a general picture is very relevant to all of that.
But there is a difference in the in that case. The if you go to the magic angle, it is about you have mod insulator instead of band insulator. Here you're going from band insulator to superconductor, and there you're going from mod insulator to superconductor. So there will be some differences.
So there will be differences, but in that sense, what I mean by the similarities is you can replace band insulator by, let's say, a featureless mod insulator. So if you have a featureless MOT insulator, which is essentially a quantum spin liquid, then that quantum spin liquid must have the pairing signatures in it, which then become your Cooper pairs on the other side. So that part goes through. Same thing you could do with attraction. You could have CDW, which basically means, you know, I have, a pair, zero, pair, zero, that kind of a density pattern. This, again, could be an insulator, CDW kind of insulator, which then becomes superconducting. So it's actually a very general framework.
Is the delta doped strontium titanate something that you're thinking about? That's a low density system.
Yeah. So one thing to keep in mind is So whenever you have delta dope, these low density things, these are prime candidates for looking for such insulators and superconductors. To really be in the, so there's one point I want to make here about seeing pseudo gap behavior versus seeing BEC behavior. So if you look at cuprates, you clearly have a dome, and that means TC is dipping down. And there's another scale which is large, like T star scale. And that doesn't necessarily, so you clearly see a pseudo gap. That doesn't necessarily say that you are in the BEC regime, because in the BEC regime, your spectrum changes from delta to delta square plus mu square. And that means if you had nodes, you wouldn't see them in the BEC regime. So you can have pseudo gaps without being in the BEC regime. This is another subtlety. But at least it tells you where to look more carefully for seeing paired insulators and BEC superconductors.
All right, one last question. We also need to have coffee. It's not a long day to go.
So can we do this stiffness? What is the reason that in this model the stiffness goes to zero in this at the same time as the two particle gap? I mean, is this just from like not having disorder?
So actually, that's interesting. No, so we have done a lot of work on disordered, one band disordered models, and we find very similar phenomenology. That phase diagram is very similar there as well, that you get superfluid density going to zero at some point as you tune, say, disorder. And beyond that, at higher disorder, you still continue to have one particle gap remaining, so your gap doesn't, single particle gap doesn't close, but the two particle gap does grow soft at that, the two come together. Because in this model, what happens is, and it's not just this model, even the disorder, it's quite generally true that the moment the two particle gap has gone to zero, you are now able to inject bosons. And the superfluid density can be very, very small because it's essentially going to zero at the boundary, but there is nothing to decohere. There's no frustration in the system that is producing Josephson junctions with kind of frustrated interactions. That would be a way where you could get some kind of metallic region and the system may not become immediately superconductive. You need some frustrated Josephson couplings. In the absence of that, any coupling is leading to stronger and stronger Josephson effects, which leads to a finite superfluid stiffness.
All right, coffee time. Let's get
Thank you.